With the year 2000 only weeks away, what Israeli security forces fear most is a deliberate act of violence by religious fanatics. The aim might be to spark the great mythic battle of Armageddon, and so hasten the coming of the end of time.
Then I saw the beast, and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war.
The key to understanding some of the wilder imagery in Revelation lies in the fact that much of it is grounded in 600 years of Jewish history. Armageddon is a real place. The word comes from Megiddo, an ancient stronghold where kings of Israel once stabled their war chariots.
Megiddo was a major fortress governing the landscape, and it's where a number of important battles took place. It's not hard to imagine the chariot wars and the other kinds of battles that took place here. There's lots of reliefs from antiquity that show just such battles happening and the victories that resulted there. Megiddo means place of battle, place of triumph. It just depends on who's going to triumph.
The origins of the Book of Revelation lie in war, defeat, and despair.
The political history of the Jewish people is central to the story. And it really begins in the year 586.
In the year 586 BC, the famous King Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, actually enters Jerusalem, burns the temple, sacks it, destroys the city itself, and takes the population into exile.
The partly restored ruins of Babylon in modern Iraq, with its great ceremonial gate, preserve the power and glory of this ancient oppressor.
Babylon was a magnificent city for its day, with huge stone walls decorated with these enormous, gorgeous pictures of beasts.
Savage beasts, mythic serpents, and many-headed dragons appear in the Book of Revelation and will haunt the apocalyptic imagination for 2,500 years.
If you think about the imagery of demons and dragons and beasts that we find so commonly in apocalyptic literature, some of it comes from this very experience of seeing the powerful images of the enemy, Babylon.
Babylon shook the Israelites' faith in their God to its core. In the Jewish calendar, July 22nd is the ninth day in the month of Av. On that day, a commemorative service is held here at an ancient fortress. Modern Israelis come here to mourn the destruction of the first temple and the exile in Babylon.
You get a great sense in the biblical literature of homesickness. We find this especially in the Psalms. How can you sing the song of the Lord in a foreign land? Destruction of Jerusalem, the exile of the Jewish people, posed what you might call a situation of cognitive dissonance. According to their religion, they were the chosen people of the most powerful God.
What went wrong? Has God abandoned us? Is the Babylonian God more powerful than our God? Is there some other reason why this fate has befallen us. They begin to think, maybe it's not God's fault, maybe it's our fault.
To answer those questions, the Jewish prophets were forced to re-examine, rethink, and rewrite their own history. And this is where the long line of Jewish apocalyptic literature begins.
The exile was a complete shattering of the hopes and dreams of the ancient Judaism. And then the prophets come in, Isaiah, Jeremiah, all the prophets, and they begin to predict this glorious future. The Jews will return, they'll rebuild the temple, the Messiah will come, Israel will realize its historic destiny.
And so the Jewish people began to rewrite the story of their covenant with God. In doing so, prophets like Ezekiel began to conjure up symbols and images, such as the New Jerusalem, that will reappear in the book of Revelation.
In his vision, Ezekiel sees the city of Jerusalem literally rebuilt, the temple standing up in the middle as the centerpiece of Jewish identity.
This gives rise to a motif that we still find in the book of Revelation, the motif of the New Jerusalem.
Babylon and Jerusalem are two eternal poles in human experience. They're the urban expressions of the idea of good and evil.